Hello everyone, before I get started with this timeline, I'm letting you know that all my anime videos from now on will be being uploaded to this other channel of mine. And after this history channel gets monetized, I'll be deleting the anime content that's on it. So go subscribe to my other channel. Now onto the scenario of what if the moon was habitable. First off, if the moon was visibly habitable from Earth, that could change a lot. Like, we could have started trying to build rocket ships way earlier to colonize it, among other things. So in order for me to make this a timeline where I can be accurate, no one will have known that the moon was habitable until the 20th century. You see, habitable is a broad concept. Death Valley is habitable to the extent that you can breathe air and there is water if you know how to find it. But it's not habitable in the way that a forested area is. This would mean that the moon looks uninhabitable from a telescope, but somehow it's like Death Valley. You can breathe the air and there's enough magnetosphere that you don't die from exposure to solar radiation. Perhaps if the far side were substantially lower in elevation than the near side, enough to retain some atmosphere. Deep canyons with some selenothermal vents may also help.
In 1966, Luna 9 would discover an atmosphere, although Soviet scientists might guess it earlier from some odd readings on the descent phase. And the first lunar mission discovers water at reasonable depths. The moon becomes a major focus of American and Soviet space programs, probably at the cost of some science missions elsewhere. It might be seen as so strategic to gain a foothold that some portion of the military budget gets diverted to space programs.
And the US decides to wind down Vietnam much earlier as cost-saving measures, knowing that Vietnam is irrelevant in comparison to establishing lunar superiority. Something unrelated to the space race is that far more people would believe there was intelligent life on the moon, even if none was found there. And far more people would believe that aliens built the pyramids due to the rock on Mars that looks similar to the Sphinx's face.
If America still puts a person on the moon first in this timeline, which they probably wouldn't, and I'll get to that later, it has a leg up due to sheer economics, and by the late 1970s has a going lunar base thanks to breathable air and water abundance, but it's still a super expensive concept, requiring a ton of Saturn V launches to get to that point. I'd guess there would be a major push at NASA to cut the cost of lunar launches, perhaps yielding a SpaceX-type reusable rocket. Maybe they only lift to Earth's orbit and there's a reusable lunar transport vehicle. The Soviets never put a person on the moon in our timeline, and it's never clear why. A pure technology deficiency doesn't seem sufficient as an explanation. The Soviets had good rocket designs and manned orbital experience. They even beat the US in putting a lunar lander on the moon first. I think one of the biggest reasons could be that the US put a man on the moon instead of the USSR in our timeline is sort of cynicism around the lives of the astronauts. Aviation has always been risky, let alone when dealing with some alien planetary mass object of which the very exosphere can kill you. So if the moon was habitable, that increases the likelihood of the Soviets putting someone on the moon, possibly even before America. If they put someone there, but after America, then chances are it's more risky for Russia. I mean, they can't pull it off as much as the US did. It's also possible that the Soviets realize that the moon will be dominated by the US and become a significant US military advantage in some way. I'd wager that the relatively easy, minus the getting there part, lunar colonization produces some level of demand for global inclusion into lunar colonization, which the Soviets use to try and leverage inclusion. I'd also bet the USSR doesn't try to hide its lunar success, but probably does try to put a spin that's as positive as possible, and maybe hide the fact that their presence is smaller and much less sophisticated than the American one, which is likely much more resource-intensive and capable. For example, we might get a message from the Soviets saying, "We have a moon base," with a blurry photo of a metal cylinder. While the message from the Americans would say something like, "We have a moon base, but room service stops at midnight, and the pool is kind of small. Some guys have to share a double room, and we only have a black and white TV." So it's not great, but we had Bob Hope and Miss February, 1968, put on a great show last night. If the USSR makes it to the moon moon first in this timeline, I could see several variations occurring. One is them trying to cover up the fact that they landed on the moon and attempting to establish a foothold on the moon before it's discovered that the moon is habitable. Another is that this revelation spurs a huge effort by diplomats, politicians, scientists, and potentially civilians from all over the world to bring about an end to the Cold War so that humanity can collaborate on lunar colonization, exploration, and exploitation. Something else that's important to mention is that people will try to make it as livable as possible regardless of who wins the space race. Having a moon base would be the ultimate middle finger to the other side in the Cold War. Not to mention it's gonna serve as the ultimate contingency plan for if the Cold War gets hot. After the space race, it means instead of sending aircrafts like Apollo and the lunar lander that are one-use items, they would be replaced with an orbital cycler and a reusable lander that can be refueled on the moon so it can be used over and over. It would also make an O'Neill mass driver moving lunar materials to orbit for construction a lot easier since the workers don't need to be cycled to Earth so often for R&R, like a massive truck stop. But in any scenario where a war over the moon is averted, it could have significant effects on humanity. If significant HE3 deposits are found on the moon, then it's possible, but not definite, that the world could transition to a cleaner power source even faster. Medical and technological research that is considered dangerous or controversial could be moved to the moon, potentially resulting in massive leaps in various fields, for good and bad. I said not definite earlier, since we can't master fusion, and HE3 fusion isn't any easier, and it would most definitely increase the odds of humanity going onwards to Mars, and potentially even further afield. Lastly, it's gonna be hella expensive to haul stuff to the moon, so large-scale science is probably unlikely due to the costs of equipment, people, and supplies. So I'd say most likely some researchers would live on the moon, like in Antarctica, and maybe rich and crazy people visit. But even having the moon as an off-world tourist attraction by the 21st century is a big stretch.